most of us in bit parts were just jobbing actors that were going from one movie to the next, or one TV or one theatre, if you were lucky. And incidentally, it was a lot easier in 1976 than it is now to work. So, but we were all kind of just interested in the next job, really. So, and I think it's a bit the same today, is the fouisson, which is a bit of a nerdy word to use, but the fouisson of getting a job lasted an instant. Everything after that point is terrible. It's downhill from that point after getting a job. But Greedo only became Greedo later on in life, not from the point that I got offered Star Wars, which wasn't Star Wars, which was Blue Harvest and something else before Blue Harvest. So at the point of getting the job, I was pretty nonplussed, to be quite honest, but glad to be doing something. And 1976, and it was through Anthony Daniels that he very kindly, because we were working together in a thing for the BBC called Jack and Ori, which was the original, you know, the kids' TV series, Jack and Ori. I was doing a little bit in that, and he rang me up one evening and said, I'm doing a sci-fi movie, and the director needs other actors. Are you interested? And I said, oh, go on then. And the next morning, I found myself at Elstree Studios meeting a very young George Lucas, who... it didn't even feel like an interview or an audition. He just explained a bit about the script he'd done, which sounded kind of interesting. And the next day after that, I'd got the job. And about a month after that, I was at Elstree doing a life mask for Greedo. But I had, until I got the script, which was about 6 weeks later, I had no idea what the character was going to be or what my scene was going to be, if anything at all. And it, only when after I read the scene, and incidentally, I've still got the original script of Star Wars, which is like a telephone directory. It was vast with much stuff in it. Did I think, oh, this sounds pretty cool, because it was a cowboy and Indian scene. It was the gunfight at the saloon. And I thought that bit of it was pretty cool. So I thought, oh, this is kind of interesting. So the real moment came up when I saw the movie, because I didn't go to the premiere. I was actually doing another job. And so I got to see the movie about a year later. And I was in Leicester Square, at the Big Odeon in Leicester Square, with a crowd of punters, and watched the movie. And like everybody else, as soon as the battle destroyer goes across your head, I was caught, because I kind of liked sci-fi. And I was so excited halfway through the movie that when my little scene came up on screen, I jumped up and said, "That's me!" I was so excited. So it was a moment, but only about a year later.
Have you ever discussed with Warwick Davis about him doing the media version?
I have, yes. I asked him. I said, Warwick, that was you, wasn't it? And it was...
Phantom Menace.
I said, was that supposed to be Greedo as a young kid or as a great... And he said, George never told me. So all I gathered was that he was a Rodian of some kind. But yeah, I have talked to him about it.
You had to see the character fleshed out as he was in the expanded universe book.
Yes, he has been. I haven't read all that many of the expanded universe, but I do know what you're talking about. I have read a few bits and pieces. Yeah, I mean, it would be marvellous to see. Never in a million years did any of us in 1976 think that we'd be talking to you guys in 2018. If being still alive was considered, because most of us are dead. In fact, I am dead. They did dig me up for this. But it would be lovely to see Greedo included, because a lot of the characters, as you all know, have other lives in other movies. I mean, Greedo's been in almost everything, including Family Guy, The Simpsons, and Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. So he's kind of an icon in other... And I believe that scene... that little tiny scene that we did is now number 14 in the all-time great sci-fi moments of history, which is just absurd but wonderful at the same time. So yes, it would be lovely to see a bit more about Greedo, even though he was a terrible assassin.
one of the big questions actually that I wanted to segue to, which you probably get asked a lot, did Han shoot first?
Well, yes, of course he did. I know, because I was there. And if I'd shot first, I would have run off with Princess Leia. I would have defeated Vader. I would have certainly shot Jar Jar Binks, eaten the Ewoks. I would have barbecued them gently for a few minutes because they taste better after softening. But yes, he certainly did. We were this close. How could Greedo miss? I mean, what a terrible... The other point was, of course, he did go to Assassin College, but a close range day, he was at home with Mrs. Greedo. Grassy Knoll, he would have been fine because he'd done the training. Exactly, yes, he went to the same college as the stormtroopers. So yes, it's he did definitely shoot first. Incidentally, nobody shot at all, actually, in reality. Greedo met his demise as a dummy being blown up in a seat. That's how he died. But because, of course, in 1976, and to a certain extent today, nobody knows how to do a scene until the point you come to do it. And then in 1976, there were a lot of special effects guys and a jelly nightman on every movie who you dreaded because he would always try and do something disastrously dangerous to you. Because as actors, we're pretty tenor-penny and you can always get another actor as that one is being wheeled off to hospital. So as my point in being shot happened in the now famous scene, they stuck a dummy and filled it full of explosives and blew it up, which of course went everywhere and destroyed half the set, and then they had to set it all again and took the burning costume off it and put it on me, which is why I died pretty quick, going falling onto the table rather than a long, prolonged death. But yeah, so nobody shot at all, actually, in the original.
Did you ever get a chance to go back and speak to George after that cinematic moment that you had, or to Harrison since?
I did it was years and years ago, but not long after the movie had come out, and I virtually it was George. Thank you very much. And mind you, he was always pretty as a director. He was quite shy, and rather retiring, really. He wasn't one of those sort of big hands-on directors who would direct you every moment. So he was always kind of a quiet and shy man. But yeah, I saw him a couple of times. I've seen him since, but he's always been whisked off somewhere in some limo before. And Harrison I haven't seen for years. I do remember saying to him once on set, because he was asking us where he should go for a holiday in England, and I think I was the one who suggested, why don't you try going on a barge, because it's quite fun going down the canals and things. And then I think he took his Callista Flockhart on a barging holiday, which she loathed. So sorry about that, Harrison. I you know, don't come to me for holiday advice in future.
Greedo's revenge.
No, Greedo's revenge was when I actually saw Han Solo die. I was the only one in the cinema with everybody else sort of in tears and me going, yes, 40 years it's taken. Finally, Greedo gets his revenge. I've been very lucky, really. I mean, I'm retired now. I don't act anymore, but I retired about 2 or 3 years ago. A, because I love doing conventions. That's fantastic. Going all over the world, meeting people, and they give you money. I like that a lot. And as an actor, it wasn't as easy as that. But I was very lucky. I mean, I spent 2 or 3 years in Hong Kong working over there in TV and the odd movie. Did a lot of dubbing. I worked in a theatre company over there with a lot of Chinese actors. I've worked all over Europe and the UK in the theatre. I worked in the West End 4 times. I was in lots of shows in the 70s and the 80s. I was king of fringe in the 70s and the 80s, doing every anti-apartheid show there was in all the major venues like the Royal Court and the Soho Poly and the Almost Free and the Roundhouse. And so I worked with lots of nice people. I was very lucky in that point of time. You could kind of finish one job and go on to the next one, which is not so easy for youngsters today. And we managed to survive as actors, with bits of, obviously we're out of work from periods in between, but not for very long. So, I mean, I lived a charmed life, really, as an actor. Far too much, some people would say. I did 2 commercials in China, one of which was quite famous because it was round about the late 70s, early 80s in Hong Kong. And it was the first commercial that they did, I think it was for a hotel chain, with a couple taking a Chinese couple out to supper at a very snotty Italian restaurant. And they order in terrible Italian, trying to show off to the 2 Chinese youngsters who were there, the sort of young married couple. And the Chinese in fluent Italian order perfectly. And the Chinese went mad for it because it was the first time a sort of expatriate English couple were taken the piss out of in China. And they adored that because prior to that, none of that had ever happened. So it became quite a famous commercial. I loved Hong Kong. I mean, that was fabulous. And I worked in Singapore as well. I did Madam M. Butterfly in Singapore years ago, which was fun too, and worked all over Europe. I worked in Austria a lot, in Germany and France, touring. I did a couple of tours actually with Jeremy Bullock. That's how I got into doing conventions, who is Boba Fett. And Jeremy, we were doing a thing for Derek Nimmo. Do you remember Derek Nimmo, the guy who used to do all Gas and Gators? And he had this wonderful touring company throughout the world. And you'd go and play in hotels. And Jeremy and I were doing an Alan Ayckbourn, I think it was, somewhere. And he said to me one night, we were backstage, and he said, "You were in Star Wars, weren't you?" And I said, yeah, I did Star Wars. And he said, "Why don't you do conventions?" And I said, "What's a convention?" So he was responsible for me for getting into conventions. Thank you, Jeremy. The check's in the post if you're awake. It never ceases to amaze me how nice people are at these conventions, because I can only be nice for so long, then I revert to my horrendous self. You know, that's the worst bit about it, really. But no, it's been entirely joyous. They're really sweet, most of the people here. Crazy, but sweet. Every sci-fi film in the 1970s was Attack of the Killer Tomatoes, so I thought, oh God. But we were desperate for the work, so I said yes. So the next morning I turned up at Elstree Studios, or a week later or something like that, and to a very, very deserted Elstree Studios, apart from the big soundstage, which is now the famous soundstage there, George Lucas. Soundstage, and there was a big mock-up of a few things at the one end of the soundstage, and a bit of the Millennium Falcon. I didn't know what it was at the time, so I went over and thought, oh, that's quite impressive. There was nobody around because it was very early in the morning, apart from one guy in the corner. I went over to him and said, "Oh, you couldn't get me a coffee, I'm desperate. I haven't had breakfast yet." And he went off and got me a coffee, and as he came back, I said, "Do you know anything about a movie being made here? I'm supposed to see some bloke called some George." He said, I'm George Lucas. And that was how I got the job. God knows how I got the job after that. But he then gave me the job.
Documentary was released elsewhere in 1976.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
What was it like going back and recording things for that and being involved in that?
Well, that was extraordinary, really. I mean, that was... I understand the sort of... the obsession with every minutiae in detail, but we sort of got involved in it. We were all sort of pulled into it from the idea that what were we doing as actors in 1976, and how did we, you know, as incidentally, how did we find ourselves in a franchise like Star Wars? So that was kind of quite attractive. And then the guys who were doing it were very nice, sweet guys, and they were pretty professional, and they knew what they were doing. So it seemed like a good idea, which I think it was. And I've seen the finished film, and I enjoyed the finished film quite a lot. But it was damn hard work because most of my bits that they did, they came down to my house in Dorset, because I live in Dorset, and we had to feed the bloody crew, which was the first time ever and the last time ever I'm going to feed a crew, because the only people you shouldn't eat with is the crew and actors, you know. But that's how I, got involved with it, and I think they did a good job. I actually, John, who directed it, said, I want to get hold of your old... You were in Crossroads, weren't you, Paul? I said, yeah, I was in Crossroads in the early days. I said, yeah, I remember. I had an affair with Miss Diane, which was, fairly iconic, I thought. And he said, oh, I'll get hold of some of those... those old tapes. So I think he spent about 6 months going to the old ABC, as it then was, or, I mean, we filmed it in Birmingham or Nottingham, I can't remember where, but he had to wade through at least 100 episodes of Crossroads, and he was almost crazy by the time he'd done that. So I don't think he's ever spoken to me since, because he flung the CDs at me when I saw him, but it serves him right, for having to do that. The merchandise, of course. Do you know the archetypal story about George Lucas bought the rights, and the guy who sold them to him is in a concrete pillar in in LA, which, because they were immense. I mean, what's it been, 40 years of merchandising, which virtually created merchandising. And they've changed considerably from day one to today, in that today's are incredibly sophisticated, brilliantly produced and manufactured, and very varied, as indeed is the fan art. I mean, a lot of the posters and a lot of the artwork is just delightful now, and you'd want to own. 40 years ago, not so much. You didn't really want to own too much. But I do get sent bits and pieces from time to time. Thank God, Hasbro. Yes, I love you, Hasbro. They send me a few bits and pieces, and Funko and all that sort of stuff. So I have a little attic at home which has a few sort of special bits and pieces, as indeed some of the stuff that the fans do, which is tremendously talented now, and so we do keep a few bits, and every so often my wife says, that's got to go, and that's got to go. The funniest bit I ever had was had a knock on the door from the postman. I live in Dorset, in a rural village, and postman was there with a package this big, and it was the head of Greedo, which was about that big, from an American company, and I had no idea what to do. In fact, it's still in my attic to this day. I was going to put it on the roof, but I couldn't get it up there. You know, like the guy had the shark on his roof in Clapham. Well, I was going to have Greedo's head just sort of leaning over from... I don't think my neighbours would have liked that too much. But yeah, so I do keep one or two odd bits. I did... It's a fairly well-known story now, but I did keep the gun that I used in the original scene, which was unusual, because in the 1970s there was nothing from a movie you wanted. It was all junk. You couldn't wait to leave, basically. So, but the guns were great, the little guns that the props department had used in most of the first movie. All our handguns were German Mausers, which had little bits of plastic put on them to make them look like space guns. And I liked mine. I thought, I'll take that for my kids, who were very young. So I gave it to one of the boys when he was about 3, and he played with it for about a year. And then he snapped the plastic bit that they glued on off the front off. So I threw it in the bin. Do you know how much? That gun would be, it's the second most iconic gun in all space history. There's only Han Solo's, which is more iconic, really. And I threw their private education in the bin. So that, I do regret that, of all the merchandising.